You're on.
Hello, my name is Joanne Davis. It's January the 7th, 1993. And we will be conducting the history of Paul and Shirley, which is my mom and dad, how they met, their marriage, and just a review of their past relationship and the greatness that that has brought all eight of the Davis kids about. So here we have Paul and Shirley Davis.
Thank you, Joanne, for that nice introduction. This is hopefully a family history that will go on and part of the family treasured records. I would like to start with, I met Shirley, my wife, and I can't remember the date. I think it was February. It was in the winter months, the first week of February, second?
I can't remember either, but yeah, I know it was in February. That's when I first came out on a vacation for a month. And it was...
1960?
I'd like to guess at 1963. Oh, no. It was after your dad had died. What year did your dad die?
63. And 64. And Kennedy died in 64.
I met Paul 4 months after your dad had passed away. And he had passed away in November, and I met Paul in February. So that's 4 months later.
That's the same year that Kennedy died.
I thought Dad was alive when Kennedy passed away.
Oh, maybe. I might be getting the dates mixed up.
Yeah, but Kennedy did die in 64. So if we... this is Kennedy's 25th anniversary. 25th this year. 91, so 66. Can't be.
We got married in 1966.
And we met 2 years before that.
So, 2 years before, that would be 1964.
Shirley had an aunt by the name of Agnes and Victor Malcoon, and my mother and father knew them very well. They would visit quite often. And when Agnes knew that her nieces were coming from Danbury, Connecticut, which would have been Uncle Victor's sister's children, he called, they used the chain of command in those days. They called the parents first to get a feel for, are the boys available? Are they interested? And how do we put it together? There was two of her nieces coming down from Connecticut, Danbury, Connecticut, to visit the aunt and uncle, and the first time that they had ever been out west. So they came out to see the what it's like, this southwest, and to see the Indians and the horseback riders and all the western scenes that you see on TV. That's what they thought that they were going to see out here.
Well, I couldn't believe that there were still Indians around. I thought it was just in the history books. And then when I came out here, and Uncle Victor said, why, sure, there's Indians, all types of Indians here. Navajo, and Zuni, and Pima. And I says, really? But you mean they're still living around here? And he says, sure, they have their reservations, and a lot of them are in town now. And so it was interesting to know about that. And so back to the first day that we met, Aunt Agnes, Marilyn and I had come out here, and Aunt Agnes and Uncle Victor decided that they would introduce us to a couple nice guys. Well, we didn't know anything about it until after she had it all arranged, and then she told us that we have a blind date for you on such and such a day. I think it was on a Tuesday evening. And when I heard that, I said to myself, oh no, I don't like blind dates, because you never know who you're going to end up with. So anyways, we got ready anyways, my sister and I, and Aunt Mamie. We got ready and we got dressed, and they came over, and I remember them sitting in the living room of Aunt Agnes. Christmas, Uncle Victor's house, and Johnny, Uncle Johnny sat on the corner of a sofa, and I started talking to him, and Daddy was sitting talking to Uncle Victor. And I remember looking over at him and seeing how straight he sat in the chair, and I said, nice posture, you know? and then going through my mind was, gee, I wonder which one I'll end up with on this date. Would it be Uncle Johnny or would it be Dad? Because we didn't know. So it came time to leave, to go out, and we went to the car, and Dad opens the door, the front door, and I jump in because I didn't want to sit in back. So Marilyn, in the meantime, nudges my foot like that because I think she wanted to sit in the front. But anyways, it ended up where we didn't even know who was going to be driving. But Danny ended up driving, and Uncle Johnny and Aunt Mimi were in the back seat. And then the first date, I forgot, where did we go on
that
first?
We kind of gave you a tour, it seems to me. Drove you around Lincoln Drive, showed you the resorts up there. That's my memory. Maybe we stopped for coffee someplace. Uncle Johnny and I had a routine. It was not unusual that some of the Lebanese families would call us to help entertain their children, their visitors that come out of town. As a matter of fact, I think a month before that, there was two girls that came from Australia, and Uncle Johnny and I just gave them the tour. We take them to a Mesa, show them the Mormon church, we'll go show them the state capitol, we'll go up to Camelback and show them the sites of the resorts. At that time the Camelback Inn was a pauper place, the Biltmore, and then one of the fancy coffee houses. And that was just a routine that we got attached to, and it seemed to favor the company. Then we took you home after that.
Okay, and then after that, well, Uncle Johnny started calling Aunt Mimi for dates, and then I wouldn't hear from Dad, and I'd say, well, how come he's calling you, and Paul didn't call me yet? But then the following day, after Johnny, I'd hear from Dad, and he'd call, and then I think we doubled for the first few dates. Then after that, we split. I went with Dad on dates, and Mimi went with Uncle Johnny. One of the places I remember they took us to was the Mormon Temple, and all the grapefruit trees all around there, it was just beautiful. And another place, another restaurant I remember we went to was called Callie's.
Yeah.
And it was a nice restaurant.
On Central Avenue.
Went
to the Japanese flower gardens on Baseline.
Right, I remember that.
Beautiful scent of the flowers that were blossoming at that time, and it's a beautiful view. Rows and rows of stock flowers. Just
well,
nice.
I have to mention that another thing that impressed me about Dad was when we went over to meet Cynthia, okay? Uncle Johnny and Mimi were there, and Dad and I, and I remember we met Grandma, and we were sitting there. And all of a sudden, Dad and Uncle Johnny got up and went in the kitchen, and Cindy and we were conversing. And then they came out with all these cute little hors d'oeuvres. And I couldn't get over how nice it was for the men to get up there. They didn't bother their mother. And they went in the kitchen, and they took care of the drinks and hors d'oeuvres. I thought that just surprised me, because I know at home, you know, it's always like my mother or one of us girls always gets up and prepares things. So I says, gosh, that's great. So that really left something on my mind there.
Then we went to a dance, Valentine's dance, that the Cedars put on.
Uh-huh. I remember that's the first time I met Rose Nash.
Yes.
And her daughter, June.
Right.
In fact, that was the time that the mother had fallen, or she had tripped or something like that happened. But
then on our way home, is that when the rain stalled the car?
It may have been that night.
Yeah, it was that night.
Yeah, we had doubled again with Marilyn and Johnny.
And the car just plain stalled. I think it was somewhere near 20th Street and Thomas, on our way taking Mom home to Agnes and Victor's. So, you know, I was on my dress clothes. I didn't want to stop to try to fix the car. The battery wouldn't turn over anymore. So I offered to walk them home, but they didn't like that. Took that as an insult, so we called a taxi, and we took you home. And I don't know how we got the car to the house. I can't remember how we did that.
Anyways, time went on, and our vacation was going on, and I said, gee, you know, we did come out here for a couple of things, and one of them was to go out to up to Las Vegas. And another thing was we wanted to go to Hollywood, California. We always wanted to see the stars and find out how they made movies and what went on over there in Los Angeles and Hollywood, California. So I didn't want to go anymore. And I told Mimi, I said, gee, you know, I feel like staying, you know. And I knew why, because by then I had taken a real big shine to Dad. And Mimi apparently did it with Uncle Johnny, and she said, "Will you promise me that we'd go over there?" I says, "You know, you're right," and I always try to keep a promise. So as much as I didn't want to, I did. So we went over to Hollywood, California, and we met Uncle Jim and Aunt Pauline and their kids. They were all little kids, real small. One was a real baby. I don't know if it was Denise or Jeffrey, but and the city they lived in was
North Hollywood.
Yeah, I think it was Hollywood at the time. Yeah. But they were very nice to us, and Uncle Jim took us on a tour of the city that night, and then we took a tour later on of Hollywood itself, the movie studio. And we went into dressing rooms of the stars and all. And then we came back to Phoenix after that. And then Aunt Agnes said, if you're going up to Las Vegas, I'm going to go with you. And I says, well, if you really want to, you know. So we took a bus. We took a bus up to Las Vegas. And it was fascinating. That was the very first time we ever saw a city like that. We were astonished, but we took in some shows, and we took in a lot of good eating places, and we had a lot of fun. And on the way back, we took the bus again, and I had fallen asleep in the back of the bus, and I thought Aunt Agnes and Auntie Mimi were nearby, too. So I felt comfortable, so I just fell asleep. Well, the next thing I know, I woke up and I felt somebody's hand on my leg. And I woke up and I saw the stranger sitting next to me. And he had his hand, and I quick jumped up. And I looked for Aunt Agnes, and it seemed like she sensed my fear. And she got up and she came over. She said, you all right? Come over here with me. So I got up and I went with her. She really saved my life because I was in a state of shock. And I was never so happy to get home, get back to Phoenix again. And that was a scare for me. So we got back here and we dated again. We went out, and then the month was over. I had to get back to my job back home. I can't remember exactly what position I had at the time. I was probably working at Glen Hill Convalescent Center. Anyways, I went back home and I told everybody about this great guy I met, and I really felt I was in love and all this, and I was just in seventh heaven, you know. And my mother thought I was crazy. She said, now, calm down, what's wrong? Just relax, you know. And I said, I can't help it. I said, something hit me, you know. And she just, she couldn't get over me. But time went on, I went back to my job. In the meantime, Dad would call me every week, And seems like Saturday nights he would call.
Yeah.
And
let me tell you a little scene that you skipped at the airport when you were leaving to go back to Connecticut. I know Shirley was very emotional. At this point, there was a shine to Shirley. No more than that, I didn't know if it meant love or if it meant infatuation, if it meant anything. I says, the only way I know is just by dating. How else do you know? You know, by spending time and talking and going out. So at the airport, Shirley was very emotional. She was crying, and I couldn't understand that.
Yeah, that brings back memories. I remember crying.
She was shedding a lot of tears.
I couldn't understand why I was crying so much. I said, I says, maybe I won't ever see you again, you know?
So I remember that very well because I didn't understand that expression. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're, and Shirley was around 22, 23, and I was about 33 at that time. So,
that's about
24. Then we would communicate, and I kept encouraging Shirley to, the only way we could really get to know each other is to come out here. And I think I made, the World's Fair was going on, and I made that trip.
In 1965, the World's Fair was going on, and Dad came up, and he visited, and we went over to the World's Fair. And I think he also stopped in Canada to see his relatives.
Yes.
And then he met all my family. He even met my grandmother, my grandmother Vaid on my father's side. And my grandmother really liked him. And he got to meet everybody, our priest and friends, neighbors, relatives. And I think he stayed 1 week or 2 weeks, was it?
I remember a week. The whole trip was 2 weeks.
Okay, so you stayed a week at
a
our
week
house?
Right.
Was it?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then you did come up another time, and I can't remember exactly when, but I remember one thing. That second time he was supposed to come, I was dating this other guy in Connecticut by the name of Bill O'Neill. And Bill told me that he was taking his vacation a certain time, and in one of Paul's letters, he mentioned his vacation, that he was going to come up a certain time, and it was the same week. So I was stuck. I said, what am I going to do? Now, Shirley, stop and think, who do you care for more? And I said, well, of course, Paul, you know, than this other guy.
She had a backup.
I told Bill one night, I says, Bill, you know, I says, remember that friend I told you I met in Arizona? Well, he's coming up the same time, all the way from Arizona, the same time as your vacation. I'll never forget, he just looked at me and he says, well, what do you think this has been? A platonic relationship? And that ended it. I never heard from him after that or anything. But in the meantime, Dad comes up and we had a good time together. He kept encouraging me to come out to Arizona so we could get to know one another more. And so I kept telling him, well, maybe after the new year. Now this, we corresponded for one whole year. And then after that, I came out in January, after Christmas and after the new year, I came out. And I stayed with Aunt Agnes and Uncle Victor for 3 weeks. And then Dad found a place for me near the hospital because I didn't have a car, and I had to walk to St. Joseph's Hospital back and forth. And there was a roommate, Mary Johnson, and she was the nicest person ever. And she was an LPN, and we got along real great. And I stayed out here from January until about, I would say, end of October, because that's when Dad proposed. In the meantime, I knew that I loved him a lot, but he kept procrastinating, you know? And I couldn't understand why he wouldn't propose, because I loved him so much, not thinking how much he loved me, but because I loved him so much, I thought
it should work.
It was equal, you know. And I kept saying, well, "What's wrong with him? Can't he see I love him? You know, can't he, you know, all this?" And yeah, I had some pride. I didn't want to, you know. I mean, in those days, you never ask a guy, you never called a guy up, you never even asked a guy out. You never, not like today. This generation's a lot different. But anyways, we went out a lot. I remember one weekend, I wondered why I never heard from him. And my girlfriend was with me. She says, "Why don't you call him and see where he is?" I says, "What? Call up? I never call a guy up." She says, "Go ahead. I dare you," she goes. So I says, "Oh, all right, I will." So I dial his house, and Cynthia answers. "Hello? Who's this?" I said, "Oh, this is Shirley." I says, "Is Paul there?" "No, Paul not here. Paul Percio." I says, "Oh, he's on a retreat?" And Cynthia says, "Yeah." I says, "Okay, just tell him I called." "Okay," she said. Then I knew he was at a retreat, and I felt better because I didn't hear from him that weekend. We usually went out on weekend. So, what else can you think of? Oh, in the meantime, I had another girlfriend who was a nurse who had a boyfriend who kept telling me, "You got to do something about him. You got to get him going. You got to do something to let him say, 'Shirley, will you marry me?'" And I said, "What do I do? You know, I don't know." And he kept going. He was a psychologist, and he kept telling me all these different things. So you just have to get him going. You have to, you know.
Who was it?
John Wolf. It'd be Ree's boyfriend. She later married him. But anyways, what was the expression he made that time? Something about...
I can't remember. But it was very difficult for me to give up my singleness and to say that I'm going to change to become a married person. And I was enjoying my singleness very much. Not that marriage isn't enjoyable, but you don't know that. You know the state that you're in. So I was very active in the Catholic Alumni Club, and Shirley would come as my guest. And now many of our friends are becoming engaged and married, and so I'm sensing this loss of other people and their singleness and enjoying their company as they are married. And we've discussed marriage, and we've discussed when's a good time to get married, but I didn't propose. So I remember one scene where I was talking to Uncle Joe. I don't know if he remembers that. You know, if you lay everything on the table, in the final analysis, you know, you still have to call the shot. You have to make that decision. You can put all the facts in your favor and all the things that may not be what you expect, you still have to take that position and call it. You have to say that's the way life is, and you're going to make it. So I was having a terrible struggle to say, okay, at this point I will become engaged. So one, it was in November, October, when we went to the North Mountain.
Oh, it was the end of October, I remember, because I had left around Halloween.
Yes.
To go back east.
It was the end of October.
Yeah.
We went to North Mountain with the intent of proposing to telling Shirley that we want to get married. And we went up, and it's a beautiful scene and everything from there. And I told Shirley, I didn't ask for her hand. I said, let's get married, or?
No, you said, well, what do you think? What time would be good? I said, what time would be good for what? You know? he says, says, well, he says, what's a good day? I says, you mean to get married? He says, yeah. I says, well, how about next summer? You know, summertime is a nice wedding. He says, no, how about after Christmas, during the new year? I says, then? Oh, it just seemed like so fast all of a sudden, you know. And he says, yeah, because your brothers and sisters will be home from college and everybody will be home and it's a nice time of year. I says, okay, if you think that'll work out fine. And so right after that, I got things organized. I had to leave my job here at St. Joseph's Hospital in the recovery room.
We went to the CASA to get our... we just reviewed the film on the TV, and it looks good. We did a good job. I think we fit. All right. We became engaged at the Crecio Center, and Father Duran blessed our engagement. I didn't believe in diamond ring, engagement ring. That was an adjustment. So he blessed. There was a special ceremony for engagement. He blessed us, and then after that, we went over to the CASA, the Franciscan Renewal Center, and we said a prayer in the front of Our Lady of Guadalupe. And then after that, let's see. You have to help me, sure. Can't remember.
Okay, after
did you
that,
call home to tell him? Oh, wait, I called your father and asked.
Before he has permission from my father.
I called your father.
For my hand.
That's right.
And what did the father say?
Oh, he was very happy and very delighted that we're going to become engaged and married. So we already had our courtship. We didn't need a long engagement. And I thought it would be, why wait till summer? It didn't prove anything. And the timing would be better then. And at the same time, Uncle Johnny and Mother were visiting in the old country, and they were heading back in November. So they stayed with Shirley's parents until for Christmas and the wedding. When you went back, you flew, it was Halloween Day.
That I flew back to get ready for the wedding. So when you think of it, I just had November and December, just 2 months to get everything ready. Well, I had my sister Marilyn as a maid of honor and Evelyn a bridesmaid. And Johnny was the usher and Mike Michael and my brother Kenny and Nick were in. And I didn't have a little flower girl. And Uncle Joe came up for the wedding, but Aunt Helen, Aunt Genevieve, Aunt Nora, Aunt Pauline couldn't make it. So Uncle Johnny, Cindy, and Uncle Joe were there for the wedding. And then we got married December 31st, 1966, and we had about 120 people for the wedding. And we got married by Monsignor Dimitri Hatoum in St. Anne's Melkite Church on 51 William Street. And since then, they've sold the church. We don't have it anymore. And then we had a reception and a nice restaurant. I'm trying to think the name of it. Not Armando's, it was the Avalon. We had a reception in the Avalon. And there was snow on the ground, but the sun was shining. It was a beautiful day. And let's see, we had a band, and we had prime rib dinner, and we had cream of asparagus soup for part of our meal. And everybody was very kind and generous with their gifts. And I remember Dad and I going around to everybody at everyone's table, shaking hands and thanking them for coming, and they'd hand us an envelope. Because they knew we were coming back here, we couldn't carry too much. So a lot of them gave us money. And then, let's see, after the wedding, my mother had everybody come over to her house. because it was New Year's Eve then. So she had a big party there. And there were loads of people over there. All the relatives and friends came. And we had more dancing and celebrating and music and everything. And Dan and I didn't leave until about midnight. And I was hoping there was no snow. It wasn't snowing at the time, was it? Or just started?
Just a little drizzle.
So we went on our honeymoon, and we never did tell anybody where we spent the first night. And to this day, everybody keeps asking, where'd you go your first night? Oh, I bet you went here, or I bet you went there, but we still never told anyone.
Yeah, we got a hotel, because we didn't want to travel a lot after midnight and New Year's. So it was a town, oh, maybe what, 15, 20 minutes away, 30 minutes away.
Oh, it was just about 15 minutes away. Yeah. It was Newtown, Connecticut. And we stayed there for the first night. And then I remember for breakfast and lunch, we ordered a big lobster. Yeah. And they bring it in on this big tray. It was huge, a huge tray. I looked at those things, they were enormous. I says, God, Paul, you know. But we enjoyed it. We had lunch and or breakfast, whatever you call it, in bed. And then, let's see, then we went on a little tour. We stopped at the church there. And from there, we continued going on our honeymoon. And I remember we had to go through New York, Albany, New York. How cold it started getting as we headed north. And Dan told me that he wanted to go to, we never really discussed where we were going before, did we?
Not really, we just.
And so Dan says to me, let's go up to Madonna House in Canada. I says, to Madonna House in Canada on our honeymoon? Because that's a place, you know, well, he has a cousin there who's in the lay apostolate. And he says, yeah, we'll go see my cousin. He's up there. She's up there, Teresa. I says, well, okay, if that's what you want. So we started traveling north, and it got colder and colder. I remember going through Albany. The snow started coming down heavier. And then I forgot how long it took us to get up there, but finally we got up there, and then they were so happy to see us. And then they gave us this little house to stay in. And it was like, seemed like it was on a little island of it, on its own. And they said it has everything there, but no running water. And I said, oh my God, no running water. So I remember we went there, and then we washed with, we'd bring in the snow and melt it, and wash with the melted snow the next morning we get up, you know. And what else? Oh, so I met a lot of people up there, and they were all very nice to us. And then we started heading back down again.
Did we go to Montreal?
Oh yeah, I forgot. We went to Montreal, and we saw the beautiful cathedrals there. Where else did we go?
Then we headed from there. We went to Quebec. I know we went to Ottawa.
Yeah.
Ottawa, Montreal, and then headed south. And at that time, I remember there was a big snowstorm coming. So we were ahead, it was behind us. We were ahead of the storm by about maybe a half a day, because we were getting news reports how this big storm was coming. And it's a good thing, because they got snowed in. The whole countryside just got snowed in. So when we headed right back directly to Connecticut. No, we went to Boston to see Kenny.
To see Providence, Rhode Island, we saw.
Oh, Nikki.
My brother Nikki was
Providence
College at the time.
Right.
So we stopped there and saw him and took him out for dinner, and he enjoyed that very much. And then from there we came.
We went to Boston.
We went to Boston too?
To see Kenny, yeah.
Oh, okay. Kenny was in college too at the time?
Yeah.
Okay. So he was going to Boston University, Kenny. And we got to see him. And is that where the time we went up to the Prudential building?
Yes.
And we had lunch. We on the top floor of this huge, tall building, and with Kenny, and he liked it very much, and he was so happy to see us. Then from there, I think
we went to Connecticut.
Back to Connecticut, we packed up all the gifts, the rest of the gifts, into the trunk of the car. And I had all my thank you notes in there. And that's another story.
Yeah.
Those thank you notes, by the time I got to Phoenix, every single envelope was sealed. And I remember I had to put some kind of liquid and unseal each one so I can put the thank you note inside to send people, because they matched our wedding invitations. But anyways, we put everything in the back. In those days, they gave a lot of silver, a lot of silver. So we had all silver in our trunk of the car. And then we started heading south. We said goodbye to everybody, and I cried, and left Sito and Jindu and all my brothers and sisters. And then we started down the eastern coast, and we got to Washington, D.C., and we went on a tour of Washington. We saw the Arlington Cemetery and a few other places. And then we went down further south
and stopped at Camden, South Carolina, to see the people that when I was in the Army.
Yeah.
And we went to see the old fort that I was stationed at. And then from there we went through Georgia and to Florida. We stopped over in Shirley had an uncle in
Fort Lauderdale,
Fort Lauderdale,
Florida. My uncle Freddie lived there, and he was a bachelor at the time. And he says, well, where are you both going from here? We said, well, we're just going to go back, head the south, take the southern route back to Arizona. He says, don't go until you go on the Francisee. This was a ship that took you out to the Bahamas, Nassau in the Bahamas. He says, don't worry about your car. I'll drive you out to where the ships are, and I'll watch your car here in my driveway. So don't worry about it. So he did, and it was the best ever, because Paul had been doing all this driving, and you get tired doing a lot of driving, you know. So we went on this ship cruise, and it was beautiful. First time I had been on. But the first thing that happened to me once they started out was I got so seasick. My stomach was so upset. And here everybody's having a good time, and they're all, then they announce, everybody come for dinner. We have an elegant, beautiful dinner. And I said, Paul, you go ahead. And I'll meet you later. My stomach was just so upset. So then the steward came in, and he says to me, listen, he says, why don't you not drink and just eat
solid
food, and you'll be all right. I says, really? He says, yeah. So Paul says, well, come on then. I says, well, okay. I was still unwilling because I was so sick. All I felt my stomach going was like this, like the waves, I felt it. So I went into this big, huge, gorgeous dining room, and they had tables set like for about eight people. And we met this other couple there, remember how nice they were? And then they come with these big menus, this big. Anything you want out there, it comes with your ship payment, you know, whatever you pay them. Lobster and all this different kind of fish, and you could order 10 main courses if you wanted to. So I ordered something, you know, and it was great, and meeting all the other people from all different parts of the country. Then they had dancing, they had games, and I remember Dan and I won a game, and for that they gave us a little replica of the ship that we're on, Francisee. It was an Italian liner. And then I heard that to buy perfume on board the ship, it's real cheap. So I bought some Yardley English Lavender, a bottle this big, which I think lasted me 5 years. It was so big. It wasn't the spray bottle, it was the type you have to put on your finger, you know. But we enjoyed that very, very much. And we landed, we got off at each port.
Not Nassau, and Freeport, and maybe another one. Uh-huh. Beautiful. Oh, the water's all blue and just nice.
And the sand was white. The
sand was all white. But on the ship, we use that as our hotel. And every night, they'd say, okay, midnight snack. And I couldn't believe the amount of food they had out there.
From pizza to anything. And we'd look at each other.
We gained so much weight on that ship.
We gained 10 pounds.
I couldn't believe it.
on our honeymoon. Each one of us, 10 pounds, just on our honeymoon. Couldn't believe it either. So anyways.
Then we made, I think, 3 stops or 4 stops, and we headed back.
And I couldn't get over the way the people had it. They spoke English, but with the English accent, like over in England. And and yet another accent to it, like a Jamaican accent.
Yeah.
Because I remember speaking to one of the policemen and or listening to him as he was telling the cars to go by. He was standing in the middle of the road. He's, okay, Mon, you can go by now, Mon.
Yeah.
Instead of man, they'd say Mon. And and then I remember the straw baskets that these ladies would be sitting in and doing.
Weaving.
And weaving. So I bought a purse that said Nassau on it. And I had it for the longest time, and I used it for a long time. Finally, the handles broke off, and I still kept it because it was a souvenir of our honeymoon. And then finally, I can't remember when, but I gave it away.
How about that one incident when you were laying out in the sun?
Oh, I don't want to forget that one important incident. I was, we were on board the ship. It was like our first day there. And they had a gorgeous swimming pool on the top part of the ship. So Dan and I decided to put our suits on and just lie there by the pool. And it was so relaxing and so comfortable and peaceful. And there were other people all around just relaxing. But I fell asleep. And I woke up, I think it must have been an hour later, and Dan was gone. And I says, where could he have gone? Why didn't he wake me and tell me he was going somewhere? I didn't know a single soul on board that ship, and I got so scared, so I kept worried about him. So I got up and I looked around the whole top area for him. He wasn't there. Then I went to the next floor. I looked all around. He wasn't there. Then I went to the next floor, and he wasn't. Then I went way down where the boilers were, and I looked through this little window, and who's there? His dad. Trying to figure out what makes this boat tick. Oh my God! I says, Paul, I was so worried about you. Where were you? What were you doing?
Well, I had to figure out what makes this thing move. You know, it's fascinating how the ship works. So that's that. I was asking all the engineers and the captains, the principal of navigation, and very interesting. I went up to the captain's deck to see how they're charting the course. So. I wanted to know, so I took that upon
and
myself.
And I was so worried about him. But anyways.
Then we headed back to Florida. Then we went and surprised Mr. and Mrs. Kirkish.
Yeah.
Is that right?
That's right.
Frida and
Mike.
Mike. And George and Tammany.
No, Angel was there.
Angel.
And her husband.
Was George there? No, maybe not.
No.
No, Angel. So I had Shirley. They didn't know that we were coming. So Shirley knocked at the door and asked for
George Kirkish.
George or maybe.
Well, we asked for
one of the Kirkishes, and she started to visit with them and talk to them. In the meantime, I was hiding behind the door. They couldn't see me. And she had a dialogue going, and they're trying to figure out, now, who is this girl? What is she asking? All of these questions. She knows the family, and they can't put it together. But all of a sudden, Shirley gave some association, and we had a nice time. We had supper there, and then we had a nice reunion with the Kirkishes. They were lovely, lovely people.
This in Phoenix?
This was in Hollywood, California.
No,
Hollywood,
Florida.
Hollywood, Florida.
Hollywood, Florida.
Hollywood, Florida.
But we also forgot to say we stopped in a city in northern St. Petersburg,
okay.
Florida, and we went on a
horse and carriage ride.
Was it Alexandria, Florida? I can't remember the name of the city.
Well, they gave us a. Well, now we're on. We'll continue our honeymoon. We stayed about one more day in Fort Lauderdale with Shirley's uncle Fred Malcolm, and then we proceeded to New Orleans. And we stopped to see. We took a tour of New Orleans, and through St. James Cathedral, the park. Bourbon Street, some of the highlights of New Orleans. Then we went to Louisiana and saw Shirley's cousin at school in Lafayette.
Oh, we saw Herbie Bayard. He'd be my first cousin, and he was going to school in Lafayette, Louisiana. And he had at the time all his aunts and uncles living there in Louisiana because his mother was originally from there, actually originally from Lake Charles, Louisiana, which is close to Lafayette. And then from there, we went into Texas.
And that was the longest drive from one. Boy, it took us a day and a half, seems to me, to get through Texas.
I thought we'd never get out of there. Oh. It was so wide.
So we stopped at El Paso, and we went to Juarez.
Right.
Showed Shirley's,
or
the places that I used to visit in Juarez and the and El Paso. And then from El Paso, we headed to Phoenix. And that brought us, I didn't have an apartment yet to stay in. I didn't have time.
Oh, and that's what was bothering Mom. I couldn't believe that. I thought that he was teasing me all the time that he didn't have a place for me for when I got back.
I didn't think that was that important. We had each other, and that's what really counts. I thought it was important. The rest is mechanical. You can always, you know, go rent an apartment, rent a motel, or whatever you want. So the important thing is that we had each other. The rest could happen. So the first night, we stopped in at the house on 2528 North 40th Street. That's where Mother and Dad live. And Mom was home and Johnny. And we spent the first night there. And then the next night, we got an apartment at the Rock Haven Apartments. Apartment number one was vacant. And that's where we made our first housekeeping, our first unit. And it was a one-bedroom apartment. The front was a restaurant of it. And we started there.
So in the meantime, I went back to work at St. Joseph's Hospital. And I remember living in Rock Haven and putting out all my new things. I put out my pretty blanket over the... I just tried to pretty it up because I wanted something bigger and prettier. And it had plastic drapes hanging and the windows were dirty. And so I started scrubbing everything. And then I put out all my pretty tablecloth and pretty blanket over the couch so it looked pretty. And we stayed there, I think, about 3 months. And in the meantime, I got my job at St. Joseph's Hospital again, and I couldn't go back into the recovery room, so they put me on 4 West, which was a surgical floor. And then I got to meet people, a lot of friends in the hospital, and next thing I knew it, I was starting to have a miscarriage. It was my very first one. I may have been 2 months pregnant, and I had to get off my feet, the doctor said. So I had to stop working, and I had stopped working about a week or a few days when I had the miscarriage. And then we were there for like 3 months, and then we moved to another apartment, which was on the second floor called Country Club Apartments on 7th Street.
North of Thomas Road.
And it was bigger, and it was a lot nicer, and it was a bigger complex, and I was able to meet a lot of people, young people. There was a big swimming pool there, and...
What was it like going from the transition single to the married life? Your feelings on that, was it a big drastic change?
Well,
for
me, it was sort of a big change because the first thing I noticed was that I was so lonesome. I had left this big family, loving family back home. Everybody just loved one another and cared about one another. And somebody was in the house all the time, always. Dad had to get back to work, and here I was in this little apartment, you know. And I was so lonesome. I really was, and I prayed to God that I would never be lonesome again. I said, I will take all the kids you give me if you never make me lonesome again. And as you know, God answered my prayers, and he sent me 8 beautiful children. How about you, Dad?
Well, my feelings are a little different. It took me a while to find, you know, that I'm coming. I was so used to going to 40th Street House. Now I'm going to the apartment, and I always slept by myself. Now someone is sleeping next to me. That's an adjustment. And then you have to communicate differently. But these are all the adjustments of anyone in their first years of marriage. And perfectly normal. I think it's designed to newness of marriage and one another is designed to blossom and make you adjust. They're very trying, and you do have your differences, and you work them out. And that's the test. That's the test. And given with that is the newness of each other and of marriage. But you survive those because you want to, and because your love is deep. That's what makes it happen. We forgot a point to tell you in the beginning of the marriage. When Mom was walking down the aisle, or the wedding day itself, we were both very calm and enjoying the occasion. Neither one of us were nervous.
The only time I felt nervous was when I was at the house getting ready, and I looked around, and all of a sudden the whole house seemed so quiet. And I looked and found out that everybody had left. I said, oh my God, who's going to bring me to church? Then all of a sudden, I see somebody coming back into the house. They remembered that they had to bring me. And I said, oh, thank God somebody's here to take me to the church. I was so worried about it. Mm-hmm. But once I got to church, and I remember stepping out of the car, and I remember it being a beautiful day, with the sun shining, and there was snow on the ground, and walking up those stairs of St. Anne's Church. And then I remember walking down the aisle, I just felt very calm.
Were you prepared to spend the rest of your life with Paul Davis and the same Paul with Shirley Davis, or Shirley Davis?
You are, but you see, you verbalize that, but in real life, you just can't turn that page that quick. You have to work things out. At one point, you're single, and the next day, you're married. And there's two different relationships. So you just have to work them out. You make it happen.
And so the love carried you there.
The love is what makes it go. Mm,
that's good. Definitely.
That's the magic of the couple. It's the love that you have that's very deep and very interior that makes that life succeed.
And when you love someone so much, you want to please them, you want to make them happy. You care about them, and like they say, it's 50-50, but it isn't. It's 100-100. Each one has to give their all. And in a lot of marriages, it isn't balanced. It isn't. One may give more than the other. One may give 75, the other 25. But it still works out.
How did you know that this love was for you two? That you've had relationships before, but what made this love between you two? How did you know?
We had so much in common that I felt, you know, that we had a lot of things going for us that should make it work.
Well, I just felt it within me. I don't know, Uncle Joey says it's chemistry, but I don't know what it is. But I just felt inside me that I loved him so much. I can't explain it in detail, but it's a feeling that you just want to do so much for him. And give him so much.
See, Mom comes from an intuition feeling. I come from a logical feeling. So that's the difference in a woman and a man. So in doing that, you still need love to make it work. Logically, you know, I mean, she's the right person. Have everything, you know, that would make it a successful union. But you still need that love, and that's the toughest issue.
I remember when my dad says to me, well, Shirley, what does he do? I says, well, property management, you know, works with property. Well, exactly what does he do? I mean, like, what does he do with the properties? I said, I don't know. He's just property management. Well, you know, you should find out more about what he does. I says, well, that's all right. You know, I just knew that I loved him. And what he did didn't matter that much. I know today it's so different. The girls want to know how much money the man has in the bank, and the man has to know how much money the girl has in the bank. Mm-hmm. They want to know, it's just so different today. It really is.
Why don't you stop and draw for a second? Well, we're back on now. We want to tell you that this segment is basically of Shirley and I, and we hope to continue this into where we have all the children around us, and we can talk about how they were born and when they came, and our experiences with them as they grew through their younger life. Now, I'd like to tell you a scene about the one of the incidents that happened the night of the wedding. When we were opening up the gifts, we were putting the gifts to one side, and then the paper scraps and the boxes were going to be destroyed. And over there, they burned their trash. And by accident, someone picked up the bag that contained the tux shirts and I think maybe the cummerbunds and
the bow ties.
The bow ties, and all ended up in the fire. So that was that little excitement there.
So everybody had to pay for their tuxes, the shirts. Another thing I wanted to say about the wedding was that I insisted, I wanted to pay for my own wedding. And I told my mother this because I had been working as a nurse and I was saving money. And I wasn't one to go out and buy a whole bunch of fancy wardrobe. I just needed nurses' outfits, you know, uniforms and nurses' shoes and stockings. And that's all I really needed. And so I saved a lot of money, enough where I can pay for my wedding. So I told my parents, this is something I want to do. But my mother insisted that she pay for my wedding gown and for the cake. So I said, okay, you could. So I just wanted to make a note of that, something that I wanted to do. And then I paid for my sister's gowns, the bridesmaids and the maid of honor gowns. And I remember buying them all pearls and I forgot what else. And then I remember